Blackburn Baptist Church at Gallygreaves. At Bethesda Chapel in Gallygreaves, actually. Really warm welcome to you this morning, and we rejoice that the Lord is with us, because as he has promised, where two or three are gathered together in his name, he is there with us. We're going to praise him together today. Today is not just a special day because it's the Lord's Day, and a day when we regularly come together to meet here, but there is something else happening today. I'm not talking about the run. Talking about
to speak to the morning star of grace.
Let's pray together. Let's pray. Loving Heavenly Father, we thank you that we can rejoice this morning with the riches of your grace. Thank you for all that you have given to us in this week that's just gone by. Thank you, Father, that you give us all we need to eat, all we need to drink, and that we have a roof over our heads. We thank you that you take care of us. Thank you that you hear and answer our prayers, that you are ready to listen to us at any time. Thank you for your grace and your love and your mercy and your care and faithfulness to us. Because you are a great God. You are the only true God. You are the King of kings, the Lord of lords, the God of gods. And we worship and praise you and thank you here this morning. Please be with us and lead us and guide us in our time together. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. The notices for this week will appear behind me on the screen. After the service, we have refreshments in the community room at the back. You're all welcome to join us there. On Tuesday, the coffee morning is scheduled to take place from 10 o'clock till about 12 or just after. Again, in the community room, anybody, everybody is welcome to that. The ladies' Bible study this week will take place in the sanctuary here in this room at 10:45 on Tuesday. And so you're welcome to come, ladies, to the coffee morning first of all, and then come in here. The Tiddlywinks starts on Wednesday at 9:30 thereabouts. It's nice and lively with a lot of new visitors last week. That will not take place in the half-term holidays. So this week is the last before the half-term holidays, so there'll be a one-week break. The fellowship prayer meeting takes place this week on Thursday at 7:30. That is the prayer meeting again here in this room. The film club takes place on Saturday morning at 10:30. Again, it was nice and lively yesterday and well visited. And next Sunday, we have a special Sunday worship service with Paul Moores, followed by a lunch together. Please bring and share in that lunch. Paul is coming quite a way to be with us, and we would like to have this opportunity to share together once more in an after church service lunch. So that will be taking place after the service next week. During the service itself next week, I apologise, I will be in St Wilfrid School with St Luke's Church because they wanted to interview me, I don't know why, in the service. But sometime in the future we will have people from St Luke's coming here to give a testimony as well, so we'll do a spot on that. Okay, I think I've missed something. I probably have, but no. No one has anything else. Okay. Well, then we will go to our offering hymn, which is Here I Am to Worship, and I hope I follow you adequately in my playing with this morning. You know this song very well, and I know it very well, but we know it a little bit differently. So if you think, what's Alec doing this morning? It's just that I'm not fitting properly the way you're singing, so you can tell me off afterwards. Okay, let's sing to the Lord, Here I Am to Worship. Thank you. Sunday of the month, and so we're very glad to celebrate together the first hour of the Lord's Supper of Communion, which we're going to do now. And I'm going to read, to begin with, a few verses from Paul's letter to the Corinthian church, the first letter he wrote, and then just say one or two things about it. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he'd given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And then you get the following very strange words that I probably would never have put in myself. "Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. A man ought to examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body of the Lord eats and drinks judgment on himself." So let's just be quiet for a minute or two. We can maybe close our eyes or maybe not, and examine ourselves to see if there's anything wrong between us and the Lord, or between us and our brother, and ask the Lord to forgive us and go on before we share together in the Lord's Supper of Communion. Let's just be quiet for a minute or two. The night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it. Let's give thanks for the broken body of our Lord Jesus Christ. Loving Heavenly Father, rarely will someone die for a good man, but you died for us. Those who had ignored you, those who had put you out of their lives, those that didn't want to know anything about you, those that went their own way. So are we, those who made a mess of our lives. And you sent your only Son into the world to die. He died on the tree. We thank you for his death for us. And we remember what you have done for us and what you continue to do for us each day. We remember your grace and your mercy and your faithfulness to us. But above all, your love in sending your Son to come into the world to die for us. And we remember too that we have a hope, that one day soon we will be with you, that you are now preparing a place for us where many of our brothers and sisters have already gone. We thank you, Father, for your amazing grace to us. Help us never to forget. Help us always to remember who you are, what you do for us, what you have done for us, and what you will be for us in your kingdom. Amen. We would distribute the bread, and the bread it as a sign of our individual commitment and faith in the Lord. Thank you. Same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let us drink together, thankfully, as a sign of our unity and our harmony together in our fellowship in the Lord Jesus Christ. To come forward and lead us in prayer.
This morning I've divided our intercessions into five short prayers, each with a different topic, hoping that this will help you to direct your thoughts as we pray. So let us pray. As you know, as you've seen Alec put on the screen, today is the 70th anniversary of our Queen's accession to the throne. So first of all, let's pray for her. Almighty Father, some of us here, the older ones, remember the sad day when King George died. And then later, our young new queen came back by plane from an overseas visit. We thank you now that since then, she has been steadfast, loyal and very upright in her service to you and to our country and Commonwealth. We ask that you will be very close beside her today as she remembers those events in 1952, and that you will give her good health as she, supported by members of her family, continues through the year of celebration. May she be able to take a full part and contribute to all the planned events. Amen.
Amen.
Today is also a special day for Baptists because it is the Baptist Missionary Society, the BMS, Day of Prayer. And so now we include some special prayers as they have requested. Heavenly Father, first of all, we pray for the leaders of the Baptist Missionary Society, asking especially that they may know the best ways to help displaced persons who are in need in Syria and Afghanistan and South Sudan, who they are supporting. Thank you for all mission workers, and we ask that those abroad may be able to respond to the extra challenges caused by the pandemic, praying for their safety at all times. Please help them to be able to share the gospel in difficult places as they help people. And we especially remember Chad, where our link missionaries Brian and Jackie work. Lord, we ask that the BMS Disaster Fund may be sufficient to help when tragedies and emergencies occur, and also that more may respond to your call to serve overseas, and not only with the Black Baptist Missionary Society, but with other charities and societies who need them too. Amen. Now we think of our own country and all the people of its cities, its towns, its villages and countryside, and also all the world that surrounds us, so many, many people. Lord God, we pray for all who have difficulties of various kinds. Many are suffering with health problems, and there is a slow provision of care. Some have to isolate and are ill. Many have increasing financial and family worries. There is abuse, homelessness, and much, much more besides. All we can do is ask for answers to these problems and support and care for those in need. We pray for our MPs at this difficult time, asking that the truth can be revealed and the right answer be found to the present situation. And Heavenly Father, we also ask for peace between nations and an end to greediness, asking that there be a resolve to work for good and better things, not horror and war. We remember places near and far where there are difficulties following storms and all sorts of weather things and other disasters, and we pray that the right help be given quickly where it is needed. Also, we bring before you the many refugees in different places and those who are displaced and persecuted, therefore suffering great distress. And we ask for your help, comfort and support for all. Amen. Next, we pray for our church and its activities here, the community around and the church family and its leaders. Lord God, we ask that all here today may find comfort and joy as we worship together. And we ask for your presence also with those watching the recording or reading the script. Please be beside the ones who can't be here, would like to be, and those who have not yet returned since lockdown. We thank you for all who take responsibility for organising all that happens here, and particularly ask for your continued presence with our pastor and deacons. May we be able to continue to reach out to the people living nearby. And we ask for your special guidance with new plans to share the gospel with them. We bring our church family and those they know and love to you, remembering the ones who are grieving or suffering or ill, and especially those we know in care homes or in hospital following operations or having treatment. There are so many, I've got a whole list of names here. Alan, John, Howell, Jean, Colin, Joy, Bernard, and Peggy's family, as it's her 100th birthday this week, Peggy Simmons. I'm sure there are many more. If anybody would like to call out anybody's name, please do so now. Otherwise, bring them to the Lord in your hearts. Lord, we ask you to be there beside all these and so many more with your strength and love. And we continue to pray for the young ones in our families and put their lives in your hands. Amen. And lastly, we pray for ourselves. When we leave here today, Lord, may we go out with renewed commitment to you and with the knowledge that you are beside us. Help us to be faithful to all we believe about you and share it with others. And as we say sorry, please forgive us when we let you down. We ask that you keep us safe and able to cope with any problems, and also be with us in our happy moments too. Thank you for all you give us, and most of all for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we offer all these prayers now to you, Heavenly Father, in his name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brenda. We're going to sing together another song now. Come on and walk in faith and victory. This is kind of short and rather lively, so if you start dancing around, I won't be worried at all, even though others might think. If you'd like to stand up and sing when it starts, please do so. If you'd like to remain seated, also please do so.
To read from Philippians chapter 3, verse 7 to the end. But whatever were gains to me, I now consider loss for for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss because of the surpassing worth of knowing Christ Jesus, my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them garbage, that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God on the basis of faith. I want to know Christ, yes, to know the power of his resurrection and participation in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, and so somehow attaining to the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained all this, or have already arrived at my goal, but I press on to take hold of that for which Christ Jesus took hold of me. Brothers and sisters, I do not consider myself yet to have taken hold of it, but one thing I do, forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, press on towards the goal to win the prize for which God has called me heavenwards in Christ Jesus. All of us then who are mature should take such a view of things, and if on some point you think differently, that too God will make clear to you, only to let us live up to what we have already attained. Join together in following my example, brothers and sisters, and just as you have us as a model, keep your eyes on those who live as we do. For, as I have often told you before, and now tell you again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction, their God is their stomach, and their glory is in their shame. Their mind is set on earthly things. But our citizenship is in heaven, and we eagerly await a Saviour from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control, will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. Have I got a bit lost there?
Thank you, Becky. Let's just pray before we listen to a short message. Loving Heavenly Father, open our ears, our eyes, and our hearts to understand what you are saying to us and make us willing to be obedient to what you say. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Don't really look very much like Colin, do I? I did threaten to put on his hat because everyone would think, oh, that's Colin. But I don't really look like him a bit. But I'm very grateful to him for having prepared the essence of what we're going to look at this morning, because it was first on Thursday night that he decided it wasn't going to be possible for him to be here today because of his health and that of his wife. So please excuse me if I don't sound a bit like me. And if I don't sound a bit like Colin, I sort of be between two stools this morning. But what we really want to do is to hear the Lord's voice, and I think we'll do that without any doubt at all. Thank you for your understanding, and special thanks this morning to Tim, who helped with the preparation of the PowerPoint, at least the putting together of it, and a special thanks to Paul, and I suspect also to Judith for your help with the communion service preparations. Thank you very much indeed, and your help with the technical side. Our theme today is spiritual health and fitness, part 5, which is the last one. It's not a kind of test that we go about and ask ourselves questions about what we've heard in the last 4 weeks, but it's our final look at our New Year topic of spiritual fitness. We chose this topic because one of the big themes always in the month of January, which was the main time in which we were looking at this theme, when people make New Year resolutions, you can remember about making those, can't you, this year? is getting physically fit and healthy. And many people promise to themselves to do more exercise, to work out better, and to get to the gym more often. And some people maybe take up even yoga. I don't know whether that's a good thing. They want to eat better by cutting down on junk food and fast food, even bacon butties. It's terrible, isn't it? Some people have had a meat-free and an alcohol-free January. They may possibly attend Slimming World, not looking anywhere at the moment, or some other dieting group to lose weight. People may even start new hobbies or try to give their brains a new stimulus. Are you familiar with that? All this is good. We're not in any way knocking this kind of thing. And Paul tells the Christians at Corinth to look after their bodies. For the body, as we know, is the temple of the Holy Spirit. And so there is a divine mandate, a godly mandate, a mandate from our Lord that we should look after our bodies and not abuse them. Nevertheless, we're not just a physical body on legs. We're not even a brain in a body on legs. We also have an inner life, a spirit, which is made up of a heart or a soul, as well as a mind. And our spirit, too, needs really looking after well. Some would say that our spirit is our real self, our true ID, so to speak. And this is who we really are as a person. So we can't at all afford to neglect this without doing serious damage to ourselves as Christians, and as unique individuals, which we are. In the last four sessions, we've been given the opportunity to examine important themes in how we should look after our spirits or our spiritual selves, and how it all starts with asking Christ to fill us with his Holy Spirit, to come into our lives, to shape us and to mold us so that we'll be in the best possible position to fulfill the destiny that God has planned for us. So it's our task this morning, just sort of briefly, to sum up what we've done in this series, what we've learned in the last 4 weeks on spiritual health and fitness. And there are three headings to that. And the first one is a spiritual health checkup. Sounds horrible, doesn't it? A health checkup. Don't we have enough of those? But a spiritual health checkup is really in our own interest. It's good for us. If we do have a soul or spirit, which we do, then surely this is even more important than having a physical fitness check, about which we know enough. I don't think a lot of people here have gone to the gym for the first time in January. If you disagree with me, then tell me afterwards. But when we go to a gym, we usually get a physical checkup the first time we go. But a spiritual checkup is also equally important. But checkups aren't always pain-free, are they? They're not always pain-free, and they are necessary nevertheless, and are worth it. So I ask myself the question, and I think you ask yourself the question, when was the last time that we spoke with the great physician, with our Saviour God, and simply had a chat about our spiritual health with him? We don't need an appointment. Isn't that wonderful? And we won't be waiting in a queue. It's almost unbelievable, but it's true. But why don't we do it? We should be honest with the Lord and with ourselves, evaluating, weighing up, thinking about, going over where we are spiritually. And if necessary, make any changes that God brings to our minds. After all, for each one of us, as one of part of God's creation, as individuals that he has made, whom he has made, doing life God's way is always the right way. There is no other way. So Colin kind of gave me a few questions, which I've put on the screen, just to get us started. And I'm starting with me, as usual. I'm not quite sure what happens to this one. You get them all at once, isn't that amazing? Describe our relationship with God at the present time. It's kind of hard, isn't it, Ben? What words or phrases best describe our Christian life? A chore? an obligation, a delight, routine, really boring, invigorating, spiritually nourishing, non-existent, essential? Or how would we describe our Christian life, our life with the Lord? Then I think what for me is one of the most difficult questions, and maybe for you as well, maybe not. What are the factors that affect our devotional life? Well, of course, we haven't got any time for something like that. There's always something else to do. There's always something else that's more important. There's always something that's sort of urgent has to be done now. So sitting down and sort of looking at God's word, or sitting down and sort of imagining God is sitting opposite me and speaking with him, or praying to him, or talking with him, that's kind of, well, not exactly the priority, is it? What are the factors that affect our devotional life? Now, what answers to prayer have we received recently? Well, you can say, well, I haven't received any recently. He's not answering my prayers. That would be honest if that's the case. That's fine. But maybe God has answered some prayer specifically in recent weeks and recent days. And the next one, is there any area in our lives where we need to completely surrender to Christ as Lord of your life? It was W.M. Sangster, who was a great Methodist, who said, if Christ is not Lord of all, he is not Lord at all. Is there any area of our life where we haven't given that over to the Lord? Maybe. Or is there a sin or a wrong thing we are doing where we are making a mess in our lives, where we are holding on to something? We're not prepared to let it go. So you can do anything you want in my life, God, but you don't take that away, or you don't take that person away, or you don't take that thing away. If there's anything that we are holding on to, now Colin suggests we confess it by name, that we are honest with the Lord. And then number seven, do we need to seek forgiveness from someone whom we have wronged? Number eight, are we humble and teachable? Are we consciously living by the Spirit? Are we serving the Lord with joy and gladness? These are kind of difficult questions, aren't they? But I think they are good questions. And maybe it helps if you look at the homepage of the church afterwards and look at the script of this message, or you can listen again to what we are saying now and go through the list again if you wish. So there we are. We go on a little bit more now. If we don't take care of our physical bodies, what happens? We get into trouble, we get weak, we get all kinds of health problems, and the same thing is true in our spiritual life as well. If we don't build good health and fitness, we need to manage carefully our diet, our nutrition, our lifestyle choices, and our exercise. And just as it's impossible to become physically fit and healthy just by reading books or listening or watching videos, the same is true of our spiritual health and fitness. By simply reading the Bible or listening to sermons and messages, that we will not get fit. We must apply what we are learning energetically and consequently in our lives. Any physical health advice starts with a person's diet and nutrition, usually. And this applies to our spiritual health as well. We need plenty of spiritual nourishment. I've got the Word of God in my hand. We need to feed on the Word of God. As Tim reminded us in session 3, 2 weeks ago, in his first letter, Peter tells us, like newborn babes, crave spiritual milk so that by it you may grow up in your salvation. We need to eat to grow. Last year we had eat to help, but we have eat to grow. We need to eat to grow as Christians. It changes us and it transforms us into who we are meant to be. So we should take a good dose, so to speak, of God's word. Not just once a week on a Sunday, but each day to help us grow strong. This is where the daily scripture notes that some of us have maybe a help to give us a regular habit of reading the Bible. But as well as this, it's fine if we listen to Christian music in our cars or we're listening on our MP3 players as we go along. What's wrong with listening to Christian music occasionally so we can attune our hearts to what God wants us to become in 2022, independent of our age? We are never too old, never too frail to be of service for our Lord and Saviour. Equally, of course, some people put food in their mouths, but they don't swallow it because they suffer from anorexia. In the same way, it's not merely enough to listen to God's word. We must digest it by incorporating it, by integrating it into our lives. In other words, we must avoid a kind of spiritual anorexia. Solid food needs to be chewed and digested. We need to think carefully about it and meditate on it. And this will involve sharing our thoughts with other people. This is where good fellowship comes in, where we are together. But above all else, what we learn, we must put into practice so that we become not just hearers of the word, but doers only. Remember what I said on Thursday night at the fellowship meeting, the guy who comes up to a pastor, it wasn't to me, but it could have been, he says, "Pastor, I cannot hear what you are saying because your life is speaking too loudly." We have not just to be hearers of the word, we have to be doers of the word as well. And I come to the last point, holiness. Along with plenty of good food comes the need for exercise. In 1 Timothy 4 verses 6 to 8 we read, "For physical training is of some value." Remember we talked about Eric Liddell and his emphasis on this verse. Physical training is of some value, but godliness has value for all things, holding promise both for the present life and the life to come. I'm sure most of us place some emphasis on physical exercise. We probably don't walk as far as a Massey in Kenya, who walk 60 kilometers every day, at least the men do. But since our spiritual health is more important, we should put more effort and time into spiritual exercises. Paul tells us, train yourself to be godly. And the Greek word that Paul uses here is the word for vigorous exercise. Training for Paul is vigorous exercise. It's the kind of exercise that makes us sweat. It is hard work growing spiritually. It needs to put godliness and holiness into action with the help of God's Spirit who lives in our hearts. Spiritual exercise can take various forms, of course, whether it's the Bible or theological study, prayer and meditation, fellowship with other believers and church and faith activities, sharing our faith with others. Whatever it is, it takes different forms. But it's hard work. We have to be committed to it. And if we take just the first one, Bible study, as our main example, Paul tells Timothy in his second letter to him, as I think we all know, and I think Tim quoted also, "All scripture is God-breathed and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work." So if you're going to study, or if I'm going to study faithfully the Bible this year, it will take work. If we're going to memorize verses, it will take work. If you're going to get victory over something, it will take application. It will take a hard slog. And exercise has to be frequent. If you're an athlete preparing for the Olympic Games, as those that are taking place in China at the moment, they exercise daily, sometimes many times. The exercise will vary, but athletes are constantly in training mode. So if we have a passion individually and as a fellowship to be spiritually fit this year, to become and remain spiritually fit, then it's a daily habit that we need, coming to the Lord each day. As it says in James 4, he draws near to us as we draw near to him. And Colin's written something very funny, at least I think it's funny. I don't think he thought it was. "Good health entails the practice of cleanliness and good hygiene," he says. "So much poor health comes from germs and contagion. And for good health, it's good and wise to keep ourselves clear." And Colin says, "I'm sure we're tired of hearing, as part of the COVID requirements, that we should wash our hands regularly. And very unfortunately, this is the reason why he isn't here today, which is really sad. He has written in big letters, "Oops," in brackets. But the point is that we know the rules, but we should also know what the Bible says about our spiritual cleanliness. Since we have these promises, says Paul in 2 Corinthians 7 verse 1, let us purify ourselves from everything that contaminates body and spirit, perfecting holiness out of reverence for God. Perfecting holiness, that's a high goal, isn't it? It's higher than the highest pole vaulter is going to reach in summer sports. We must identify in our lives with God's help and his spirit speaking to us and using the word of God as our guide. We should identify and get rid of, throw out things in our lives that contaminate our hearts and minds. Contamination isn't good. It's not good. Just one German sentence per week would be enough, wouldn't it? We have to get rid of these things from our lives. These may be selfish thoughts or selfish desires. They might be dodgy attitudes or responses, sort of just okay. Or our hearts and minds might simply be polluted by the world for what we see and hear on what someone once called the haunted fish tank, because of these great big things that most people have in their houses. We must take time to take these matters seriously. Are we being polluted in our hearts and minds in order that we become and remain spiritually healthy? We are convinced that Christians cannot experience the abundant life in Jesus Christ without exercising good spiritual hygiene or purity on a day-by-day basis. For me, it's impossible. For us all, it is impossible if we do not keep clean on a daily basis. See, God wants to see us living our lives in the world and before the world. But he doesn't want us to avoid it. He doesn't want us to copy it. He doesn't want to be like it. He wants us to live it freely in a manner that glorifies him. But this isn't easy at all, is it? It's really very difficult. This is why we need to be filled every day and guided by the Holy Spirit of God. The Latin motto of St. Wilfrid's High School is, anybody know it? Domine dirige nos. Thank you, Lynette. Which means?
Lord direct us.
Lord direct us. Thank you. By being directed by the Spirit, we will be able to live and move in time with the will of the Lord our God. So in conclusion, God cares about our spiritual health and fitness. He wants us to become and remain spiritually strong this coming year. But this won't happen just by accident. We must have a passion for it. We must be committed to it. We must develop self-control. We must discipline ourselves to do what is right by God, what is right according to his word. And if we are not sure what is right, if we are in a grey area or we're in a long grey area, we ask ourselves the question, WWJD, you know what that means? WWJD. Lynette?
What would Jesus do?
What would Jesus do? I think you're preaching next week. We must exercise unto godliness or holiness, it says. We must exercise unto holiness or godliness. We must work at it daily. We must cast off all the weights that would hinder us. If we seek to win one of God's crowns, a crown of life, we must seek to get rid of all the weights in our life, every single one of them. We ought daily to pray as the psalmist did. And I think this is really helpful. It's a kind of prayer that we could always use with communion service as well. Search me, O God. Search me, O God. Because we can't all see the things in our own lives. Maybe you can see the things you think, well, Alec, why are you doing that? Why are you thinking that? Why are you saying this? But we cannot see the things in our own lives that don't please God. Search me, O God, and know my heart. He knows. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there be any wicked way in me. so I can change, so we can change. And lead me in the way everlasting. Psalm 139. We must allow God to strengthen us. If God shows us areas of our lives, maybe only one little thing that needs to change before we can become and remain spiritually fit, then we have to do something about it. We don't say, well, maybe next week, or I'll think about it, or I'm not quite sure about that. If God has shown us very clearly this is not right, then we should change it now. We should be serious with God so that we can be effective ambassadors of his kingdom for the sake of his glory and honor. Amen. We're going to sing together the song Fight, the Good Fight. We're going to sing it live. I'll try and play it better than I did the last one. I've gone too far. And I'll ask Paul to
Judy.
Or Judith.
Thank you.
I think I've gone too far, haven't I?
Yeah.
That's it. Thank you. So please stand to sing. Fight the good fight with all your might. We did it on Thursday evening. I think Paul and Jane will know this. And as they did in Haggate last week, which surely, I won't say what he said. No, it's fine. Shirley's forgotten it. Okay. And that's very easy. We have to do it two or three times to get it really right. But I don't think that's theologically a problem. Nobody against that. So we'll start first of all. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. Yeah, I forgot the evermore, didn't I? I kind of had to. Can we do that? You did it better than I can. Anyone to come to the front and help? I feel kind of on my own, yeah. Brenda, are you good at this? No? Okay.
I thought I could follow you.
You can follow me, okay. Let's start. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. And this time, the last time we do it, we have to hold other people's hands, or at least get near to other people. So let's look at not 2 meters or whatever is appropriate for you, or 5 meters if you're happy with 5 meters, or not at all if you don't want to do it. Okay. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore. Amen. Thank you. God bless you all. You're welcome to join us in the other room for coffee and biscuits.
Thank you.